fun day together. And missed you guys last week. It was a great time. Our family got away and had just a ton of fun. And so thankful for Michael Millay, who shared the word with us last week. And I heard he did a great job. And I'm a little worried about my job. And so, you know, it's one of those things. But also want to welcome my family. So I'm from Oklahoma, for those that are guests this morning. My family came all the way from Oklahoma this weekend. And so that's my mom and my sister and my nephew's girlfriend, and then my nephew and my brother-in-law here today. And so we're so glad to have them with us. And so why don't you give them a hand? Especially my mom, who had to put up with me for a long time. So, well, this morning we're going to continue in our series in the book of John. We walk through books of the Bible here at New Life. That's what we do. And we just started one at the beginning of October. And we're in still, I heard someone say this week when I said, so where are you going to be this week? I said, well, John chapter 1. They're like, still John chapter 1? We're 4 weeks into this. Listen, this is the last week of John chapter 1, I promise, okay? We're in John chapter 1 today, but today I want you to have a little bit of fun, because it sounds, I think you guys need that, okay? Do you need that in your life? Okay, like five of you need fun in your life, which means the rest of you are no fun, okay? So how many of you love viral videos? Oh, yeah. You can sit and waste time on YouTube, right? Like cat video after cat video, okay? Well, I want you to watch a few viral videos. These are some of those popular viral videos in the last year. See, you needed a little laughter in your life, right? There's something about viral videos that just makes you happy. It's good, right? Many of those videos got millions upon millions and millions of hits. And if you learn anything from viral videos, you can learn all the stupid things not to do, right? Like, don't play with tasers, right? Like, that's a good lesson to learn. A viral video, like these videos all, I mean, when I say millions, we're talking about millions upon millions upon millions of views. In fact, the viral video phenomenon is something that's relatively new. It was something that social media sort of created. Otherwise, I grew up in an age when you didn't have what you have now. You didn't have viral videos, right? You couldn't do this. We had the closest thing we had, right, was America's Funniest Home Videos. That was the precursor to YouTube, right? And you had to send out, that was a lot of work to get all that done. But viral videos are amazing because you know what's amazing about viral videos? Nobody gathered everybody together in the same room. There was no event where they said, hey, we're going to watch this video together. We're going to get a million hits. There's no network television show that pulled all this stuff together. This phenomenon, these videos, the reason why I even know they exist, and some of you have watched that panda video time and time and time again, the reason why you see this is because of Facebook shares and retweets and email forwards. That's the only reason you saw all those videos, because you didn't spend your day searching YouTube finding those. Maybe some of you did, but most of you didn't. It was viral. Someone shared it with someone else. And they said, you got to see this. In fact, it taps into something, right? This viral video concept taps into something that's built into us. While we do have this human nature that's wired for selfishness and hoarding, we also have this image of God that's in us that's wired us to share, right? So something we like, right? So you've all found that product or that service or that business that you just absolutely, I mean, it blew you away. What was one of the first things you did? You told someone about it. Right? That thing that got stains out that you found on the middle of the night because you couldn't sleep, right? Like, you told someone about that, and then it went from there. You shared that one from the other. In fact, all of you have the friend, and maybe you're this person, all of you have the friend who says, you got to see this meme, right? And they'll spend the next 20 minutes flipping through memes on their phone. You're like, yeah, great, this is awesome. Please let me go. You know, like, that's what you want, right? We all have that person because it taps into something that we are. We share what has impacted us. And so with that as a backdrop, I want to read from John chapter 1. John chapter 1 and verse 35. The words will be behind me on the screen. It says, the next day, John, he's talking about John the Baptist here, was standing with his two disciples. And he looked at Jesus as he walked by and said, behold, the Lamb of God. And the two disciples heard him say this. And they followed Jesus. So they leave their current rabbi and they go to follow a different one. And Jesus turned and saw them following him and said to them, what are you seeking? So Jesus has got a tail, right? And so he finally turns around and says, what are you seeking? And they said to him, Rabbi, which means teacher, where are you staying? And he said to them, come and you will see. So they came and saw where he was staying, and they stayed with him that day, for it was about the 10th hour. It's pretty late. One of them, the two who heard John speak, followed Jesus was named Andrew. He was Simon Peter's brother. He first found his own brother Simon and said to him, we have found the Messiah, which means Christ. He brought him to Jesus. And Jesus looked at him and said, you are Simon, the son of John, but you shall be called Cephas, which means Peter. Cephas is an Aramaic word. Peter is a Greek word. Let me give you an English word, rock. Okay? So he says, you're going to be called Peter from now on. Verse 43, the next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, follow me. And now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And Nathanael said to him, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Right? So like I said earlier, I grew up in Oklahoma, and we would say this about Texas, okay? Can anything good come out of Texas, right? In Ohio, we would probably say, can anything good come out of Michigan, right? Yeah. Right? So can anything good come out of Nazareth? And then Philip says to him, come and see. Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, behold, an Israelite indeed in whom there is no deceit. Nathanael said to him, how do you know me? And Jesus answered him, before Philip called you when you were under the fig tree, I saw you. And Nathanael answered him, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. And Jesus answered him, because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these. And he said to him, truly, truly, I say to you, you will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man. This is a pretty amazing story when you really think about it. This in the other Gospels, they tell the what's called the call stories. So the first times these disciples meet Jesus a little differently. This story occurs before the other gospel stories, which makes sense to us because if you were to read like Luke chapter 5, you would see them fishing on the side of the road. Then Jesus says, hey, follow me. And they put their nets down, which means that they left their jobs and they went and followed Jesus, which makes no sense to all of us because you're going, that's the first time you've ever met this dude. And yes, he just performed a miracle, but let's be honest, right? So this makes a little bit more sense to us, helping us know that they'd had some interaction with Jesus before that decisive moment. And they chose to follow him. And here's how they came to Jesus. John the Baptist says, that guy right there, he's a big deal. Behold the Lamb of God. And so the two disciples, one of them Andrew, and it's common practice in the book of John for John not to reference himself, so the other disciple was likely John the apostle. So they go and follow Jesus, and they follow him, and finally Jesus looks around, and he says, dude, there's somebody following me. I'm going to figure this out. So they spend all day with Jesus, and then Jesus, of course, does what Jesus does, and he amazes them, no doubt, with teaching and understanding. They had never really pulled together. And so the first thing that Andrew does is he goes to find Peter. And he says, come with me. I've found the Messiah. And then Peter encounters Jesus. And from the very first encounter of Peter and Jesus, you see this really powerful thing happen where Jesus literally gives him a new name. He changes his identity. He looks into Peter and he sees all the potential that Peter has. And he sees the trajectory of Peter's life because he's God and man. And so he sees that and he says, listen, I know you can't see it today, but you're going to turn into a rock. Peter's changed. And then the next day, Jesus encounters Philip. And what's the first thing that Philip does? He goes and finds his friend Nathanael. And he says, listen, I found the one who Moses wrote about, who the prophets wrote about. I found Messiah. I found the one who will save us. It's an amazing thing that takes place here. From one person to the next, they share about the transformation that Jesus has brought to their life. And in each case, they immediately grab somebody and they say, you got to come with me because I've found what we've always been looking for. I've found that thing that satisfies our heart. I can't put my finger on it all the way yet, but there's something here and you've got to come with me. They do something unique, something that's in some ways common. And they share that thing that's transformed their life. You know, when we talk about sharing our faith, or we talk about witnessing, we talk about evangelism, any words that you want to use this morning, most people get nervous, okay? Because you think about that, and you think about all the ways that can go wrong, or you've seen that go wrong, or you think about all the things you don't know. In fact, because most of the time, when we talk about sharing your faith, sharing Christ, whatever words you want to use here, what ends up happening is that some of you have this box that says, the reason why you would be here today and say, I don't do this, is because you say, I don't know enough, right? Anybody there, you know, be honest enough to say, I don't know enough? Like, they're going to ask me that one question, and then their eternal destiny is going to be all hosed because I didn't know the answer, okay, right? We think it's an information transfer, right? It's a matter of education. If I can just package it the right way, if I can just give them all the right information, of course they're going to follow Jesus. And then if they don't, then what happens is we feel super guilty. Because we go, well, I didn't give them the right information. I left a piece out. This is on me. Or we go from information sharing to sales pitch, okay? So this is where, you know, you have all the strategies, okay? There are lots of them out there, okay? The Romans Road, you have the four spiritual laws, you have all these different approaches that if you can just get them through the whole pitch and make the deal and close the sale, you're good, right? You just gotta convince them well enough. And if they don't agree, then they're dumb, okay? Right? Right? I mean, it's their fault, okay? But what if maybe it's not either one of those things? What if it's something entirely different? What if this thing that's viral? Because if you were to track history, we go viral in a matter of days here now because of the speed of technology. But this was a pretty amazing movement that started with just a handful of people. And we realize there are five people in the beginning of this story. That five people would blossom into about 4 million by about 100 years later. That's an amazing and exponential growth. How does that happen? Well, I think there's a couple of things we can learn here this morning. I want to encourage you to grab your bulletin and write some things down along the way, because I think there's some things that we can learn here along the way that will help us understand what it looks like to share Jesus with others, because this is really important. The responsibility of sharing Jesus with others is not an option for the believer. It's a mandate. Found multiple times within the scriptures, we find it over and over and over again. And so this is something Jesus, in his own words, has said to us that we are supposed to be about. And so the question is, how do we go about it? So I want to give you some practical guides this morning that are going to help you share your faith. And the first thing that you're going to want to write down this morning is that they shared with people that they knew. They share with people that they knew. You could, next to that little phrase, you could write the word relational. Okay? They shared with people that they knew. Now, I think this is pretty powerful. They don't go out to strangers. They don't grab people on the street. And listen, I believe that we're supposed to share the gospel with everyone. There are plenty of times when I have shared the gospel with someone who I just first met. And there's nothing necessarily wrong with that. In fact, the disciples will do that later on. They'll take the gospel out to a world that they don't know, but it's always along the rails of relationship. The gospel, sharing your faith, is always transferred best in shared relationship. It's always that way. In fact, if you were to look at the examples that I gave you earlier of the people who are, information, people that you just think, if I can just give them the right information, they'll do it. Or maybe you're the sales pitch person. There have been studies done on sharing your faith. And did you know that both of those things have a crazy high failure rate? Not a surprise to us, right? But let's take a look at it here. We see it in the passage here. Verse 35, John was standing with his two disciples, and he shares about Jesus. And so the two disciples then go meet with Jesus. And then when Andrew gets done with that, what does he do? He goes and shares with Simon. And then the next day when Jesus encounters Philip, what's the first thing that Philip does? He goes and talks to Nathanael. Nathanael wasn't a stranger. Nathanael is a friend. He goes and shares with Nathanael because shared relationship is always the best platform for sharing Jesus. In fact, you've got friends and neighbors in your life that you know need Jesus. You know why that's so powerful? It's because Philip trusted Nathanael. And Andrew trusted Simon. And John and Andrew trusted John. There's something about that shared trust and that shared relationship that says, in the same way that you share that detergent that took the stain out, and you go, I'm going to have to try that because so-and-so actually had it happen on their shirt, right? And the same thing is true for Jesus. Because not only are you telling them, they can see it on you. Because when Jesus changes your life, it doesn't just change parts of you, it changes all of you, and you can see it all over people. So sharing your faith is really done in the context of shared relationship. Here's the second thing I want you to take away from today is the content of what they shared. They didn't come with a big, well-devised strategy. They didn't have that yet, right? They hadn't been around Jesus enough yet. They've only known Jesus for a few hours. They probably saw him baptized. I mean, we're talking, what did they do? Well, they just revealed what they knew about Jesus to others. So you can think about it this way. You can think about it like an image that's out of focus. See, sometimes we come with all the information, and information's not wrong. You should study to show yourself approved. You should know, have a reason for the hope that you have. You should have all those things and be constantly growing in your relationship with Christ and knowledge about Christ. But most of what sharing your faith is actually moving things out of the way and bringing focus to the image. So what you're doing, in some sense, because what happens is here, is once they met Jesus, boy, it all of a sudden became clear, wasn't it? And so all they did was really clear a path for them to meet Jesus. And so what you do in your conversations is just really just bring the lens into focus. Or maybe you could see an image, because I am image-driven, of Jesus being kind of covered up. And so your job is to kind of declutter and make Jesus a little bit more visible. It's not to seal a deal. It's to make Jesus more clear. It takes a little bit of pressure off, doesn't it? Because you don't have to have all the answers then. You don't have to know everything. In fact, look at what they do in the scripture. John starts out, he says, "Behold the Lamb of God." John makes, and for a Jewish context, in the first century world, "Behold the Lamb of God" has got a whole lot of stuff to it, okay? It's not just a phrase. It's like a lot of you know, information packed in those few words. And so these guys are going, "Oh my goodness, that's a big deal. That you can't say that to just about anybody. I want to follow this guy." And then what does Andrew say to Peter? He says, "We have found the Messiah." Again, a phrase packed full of meaning. This is the Savior of Israel. This is the one they've been waiting for hundreds of years. They're just making clear that which was unclear about Jesus. Philip goes even further and he says, "Listen, this is the one whom Moses and the law and the prophets wrote about. Listen, this is the one we've been waiting for." Your job in sharing your faith is to work on along the lines of relationship, but it's also just to make Jesus more clear in people's lives. You know, I've been walking with Jesus for a long time. And what I've come to learn is that every day that I walk with him, Jesus becomes a little bit more clear to me. Right? So maybe this isn't a one and done sales pitch. That maybe this is just us helping declutter some stuff. Because I do this a lot, and you've done this too, where people come to you, maybe you've been following Jesus a long time, they'll ask you questions. People ask me questions a lot because I'm a pastor. And so they'll say, "Oh, well, what about this?" And so we'll talk about that. And all of a sudden they walk away and they go, "Oh, Jesus is a little bit more clear that day than he was the day before." That's what this is all about. Take some of the pressure off yourself to know everything. Because guess what? You'll never know everything. Trust me, that's probably the biggest amen of the morning. You'll never know everything. Reveal Christ. Now, what's interesting is this, is you have two different encounters here. You have Peter, right? And Peter's kind of the early adopter, okay? He's all in right at the beginning, okay? That's just how he operates. He's in, okay? He jumps in and he follows. But well, what does Nathaniel do? He questions him. Does Philip get all worried about it? No. What's he say? Well, come and follow me. Just come and see it. Just check it out. No pressure, dude. Just come on. You just got to check this out. He doesn't get too hung up over the reality that someone might be questioning, that someone might have trouble with this. I mean, do you realize what the content of the gospel is here? We believe that God left heaven and took on flesh, but was born of a virgin first, lived a sinless life, and died on a cross for our sins, and then came back to life 3 days later. We've heard that message so many times that it's like, it's just, yeah, sure. It's as true as gravity does. Do you realize how crazy that message is to someone who's never heard that? I mean, that's, give people the space to doubt a little bit, to wrestle through that. Can anything good come from Nazareth? Surely the Messiah is not coming from Nazareth. That cannot be right. Give people that space. In fact, that leads to sort of the final idea. they invited their friends to join them in the journey. It wasn't trying to close the deal. It wasn't trying to make the sales pitch. It wasn't trying to get them to pray that prayer in that moment. No, it wasn't any of that stuff. It was just, hey, I get it. Come follow me. Come hang out. Let's be together. Let's join in the journey together. And many times there's so much pressure for us to close a deal that we miss out on something really huge, that we can't change anybody's heart. Okay, catch that this morning. It's a big deal. You can't change anyone's heart. Premarital counseling, one of the first things we say to couples is you can't change the person sitting across the table from you. If you're married, you know that's true. You can't do it. You can't change anybody's heart. And you may say, well, duh, Josh, what does that matter? That means you need to take the pressure off yourself, because you could share it perfectly. You could get all right, and you could say everything that the Holy Spirit would even want you to say, and guess what? That person could nod their head and walk away unchanged by Christ, because you can't change their heart. But you can invite them into a journey toward Christ. You can walk alongside of them. Instead of making it about a moment, you can make it about moment after moment after moment after moment after moment. You can't change anyone's heart. But here's what's cool, is what you can't see sometimes is that the Holy Spirit's at work. Look at Nathaniel's story. Nathaniel is skeptic. He's not sure what's happening here. And Jesus walks over and says a thing that for most of us, that wouldn't trip our trigger. That Jesus says, I saw you, you know, you must be a real good Israelite. You know, like that wouldn't get it. But for Nathaniel, Jesus knew that was exactly what Nathaniel needed to hear. That was exactly what Nathaniel needed. See, what we often don't realize in these big, because we make it all about a moment, not moments, that the Holy Spirit is at work alongside you and with you. And so you may leave an encounter where you thought you did it and you thought you shared your faith, or you told that testimony, you did that thing, and it just felt like it hit a wall. Listen, friends, the Holy Spirit is churning in that person's heart. You can't change someone's heart, but Jesus can. Jesus can. And when you invite them into a journey, you invite them into an opportunity. See, instead of walking into that encounter saying, okay, I got to get them to cross the line of faith today, what if you walked into an encounter and said, I just want them to know a little bit more about Jesus today and be a little bit more like Jesus today? What if instead of trying to get them from zero to 100 in a conversation, we just went from like zero to one? That's a little easier, isn't it? And then the next day, we're going to try to go from one to two. And the next day, we're going to go from three to four, maybe. And maybe there's going to be a big thing that happens that week, and they're going to jump from like 10 to 25, because it starts just making sense. And things start working together, and the Holy Spirit sends another person their way. You see how this works? This is not information sharing. The way the gospel traveled was viral. It's from one person to the other, day to day. It was through shared relationship. Because I don't know Jesus, but I know you. So I can trust you. Maybe you're making me a little funky right now, but I'll go with you for a little while. See how this works? See, that kind of sharing your faith is something we all can do. You know, later on, the disciples continued in this pattern. They spent 3.5 years with Jesus. They saw the resurrection. They saw the risen Lord. They were filled with the Holy Spirit and with power, and they were launched out. And then just days after that all took place, they preach in this crowd, and people come to know Jesus now by the dozens, but when they get arrested for doing a really good thing, which sounds really funny, okay, but they were, and they get arrested, you know what Peter and John say? These two that were right here at the beginning of the story, you know what they say? To the religious leaders that were gathered in the tribunal, they say, you know what? We can't stop sharing what we've seen and heard. It wasn't some big apologetic. It wasn't some big persuasive speech. It was just stuff they've experienced. Boy, you know what? I bet you you can do that. I bet you I can do that. It's not so much about me trying to come up with some big idea or some big sales pitch or some really well-crafted message, as much as it is me just sharing what I've seen and heard Jesus do in my life and the life of others. Even if you've only got a little bit, share that. You can say that too. I don't know a lot. I do know that Jesus did this in me. Because we get the bar way high. I want to give you something a little bit more accessible and a little bit more biblical. Why don't you just share with friends that you already have? And when you share, don't try to convince anybody. Just try to point people to Jesus. This guy, not me. You don't want to listen to me. This guy. And then why don't you just invite them into a journey and not, you know, try to close the deal the first time you met them. Make sense? Yes? Unless the Holy Spirit tells you to close the deal, okay? There are some moments like that, okay? But most of the time, I think, with our friends and our family and the people that know us, the best route is to follow the route of the scripture. Why don't we pray together? Lord, we come to you now. We're grateful because we know that you have changed our lives. God, in some ways, we find ourselves in a story like this one where we see how it all happened. We see it happen for us. We can recount our own story where Jesus changed our life. And because of that, we wanted to share with others. The life change was so rich and significant that we wanted to share with others. And so, Father, today I pray, Lord, that you would help us, God, to walk in the commandment of Scripture that you've desired for us, that we would share you with other people. God, I pray, Lord, that would be a part of our journey. God, I pray in this moment that you would reveal to our hearts those in our lives that need Jesus. God, would you put a burden on our hearts for them? In Jesus' name. I'm going to invite you to keep your heads bowed and eyes closed this morning, and I want to talk to two groups here today. One group is those who are followers of Jesus Christ, and maybe you haven't shared your faith in your life because it's just too big, or you look at the people that are around you in your workplace or in your family or in your relationships, your friends, and you go, boy, I just don't know that I could ever share my faith with them because they're this and that, and I don't know enough, or I don't, you know, I'm worried about this and I'm worried about that. And wipe some of that, all of that away. And then I want you to do this, is to ask God, who are the three people in my life? You may even want to write them down in your bulletin. Who are the three people in my life that I just need to invite on a journey toward Jesus? Not necessarily give them the whole hook, line, and sinker, but begin a process, a thoughtful and faith-inspired process where I'm gonna draw people to Christ. I'm gonna invite them to meet Jesus. I'm gonna invite them to see Jesus. Who are the people in my life who I can help see Jesus a little more clearly today than they did yesterday? And then I want you, as you get that list together, and they're just going to play for the first couple of minutes here, and then they're going to sing a song after that as a response to God's word this morning. Then I want you to pray, because inevitably, it's easy to write down a couple of names on a bulletin or think about a couple of people in your mind. But now you need to pray for some courage and some opportunity. You need to pray for them, that God will open up their heart, that you would just begin that process. All the apprehension you have, all the questions you have, all the stuff that you would give an excuse, give those to the Lord in this moment. Give them to God. Come up with those names and then say, God, I'm nervous because this person knows me really well. or this person's an atheist and I just don't know that I can come up with, or whatever it may be. Give that to the Lord this morning. He knows. He knew before you got in this room. And yet, he has put you in their path so you can point them to Jesus. If you are here today and you're not a follower of Jesus Christ, let me have this opportunity to point you to Jesus. We talked about it this morning in great detail a few minutes ago about the plan of the gospel. Now, Jesus, if you just knew how much God loves you, you couldn't sit still this morning. He loved you so much that he sent Jesus to die on a cross for your sins, no matter how big or great you think they may be, how big your failures may be, or maybe you're here today and you've got big questions and you got hurdles and all that kind of stuff, but you have a drawing to put your trust in Jesus. All you have to do today is not take the final step, you just need to take the first step and give your life to Christ. That comes by just talking that out with God. Or you say, Jesus, I believe that I'm a sinner, that I've done that which is wrong, which is all of us, right? Jesus, I want to put my trust in you. Or I turn away from my sins and I turn to you. And Jesus, I believe that you died on the cross for my sins. I believe you came back to life. And today I'm choosing to follow you, to put my trust in you, to turn away from my life and to walk in your life. You can say that in your own way, in your own words, in these next couple minutes as you talk to God about your heart and where you are with him. Take these next few minutes just to reflect upon what the Lord is speaking to you today.